Now today, what we are going to do, we are going to focus on a very simple aspect of dynamics, rather I would say mechanical vibrations, okay? And the reason to do so is that you have seen that whatever topic we have discussed, that was really at a great depth. And if we want to deliver this again back to the students, like this way, dynamics will take one more full semester, and for you, another 4 days. So what we thought of doing it basically, in most engineering applications, we actually encounter a simple vibration problem. In fact, different disciplines like mechanical, aerospace, civil, they have their own kind of tailor-made courses they have done on dynamics so that they only give those input to the students. In our case, we thought that, okay, in all disciplines, actually, what is necessary is to establish the equations of motion for especially problems involving vibrations. So we are going to keep it very simple. For example, we see that machine foundations, we can use the spring mass damper system, and we can study how the equation of motions are going to be solved. So likewise, in civil applications, we see we have to always resort to the equations of motion for variety of problems, and so on and so forth. So ideally, what we are going to do today is we are going to study planar motion of a rigid body, and we are simply going to find out what is the equations of motion, how to derive those equations of motion. Okay. Now, as we know that for a rigid body, if we look at this way, that it is subject to external force system, now they are dynamic in nature, and therefore we can actually go to the Newton's second law and say that the resultant force will be equals to mass times acceleration, and the resultant moment, that will be equals to mass moment of inertia multiplied by angular acceleration, okay? Now, what happens in this case, in the very first day, we have actually studied the equivalent force systems. So what I have presented at the very top left corner right here is the fact we can say that this system is equivalent in nature in an way such that these equations hold. So we are saying now these are actually effective forces on the body, and body is being accelerated in this direction and undergoing an angular acceleration also about its mass center. Okay. Now when you think this problem like this way, although it can be solved, this kind of problems, but we want to keep basically very uniform pattern throughout. That means what we want to do, since we have already learned the statics, we want to really convert this problem to a static problem. Now, how do I do it? So we basically take the D'Alembert's principle. Now, what is this? I will just explain it in a very quick manner. It is basically that we want to introduce the inertia force onto the system, but how that is going to happen? But what we are really watching here is that, let's say I talk about a particle, and that particle is subject to a resultant force, which is sum over force here, and therefore we say that the particle is accelerating in this direction, and we can apply the Newton's second law, sum of force equals to mass times acceleration, very nicely, as long as we are concerned about a fixed reference system. That fixed reference system is xy. So we say, now particle at A, the absolute acceleration is whatever the acceleration at this point A, and we say sum of force equals to mass times acceleration. Now, what happens if I really move this reference system and attach this to the particle itself? That means we are saying now that the observer itself is accelerating with an acceleration A. So my reference system is being moved. So that means now I have to really attach this negative MA such that net force should be equals to 0. So that is the basis of D'Alembert's principle that we are going to work. So ultimately now we are going to talk about two different systems. So this system is actually our inertial frame system, so fixed frame system. Whereas this one that is attached to the particle is actually non-inertial reference frame system. So that's the basis of D'Alembert's principle. Likewise, if we look at the rigid body motion of a, let's say, a planar system, then we can say that, okay, whenever we are looking at this body, we are simply going to add a mass times acceleration on its CG. That will be my translational force, inertia force, and I should also have an rotational inertia force. Now these two forces are going to always oppose the motion. Yes. J is the mass moment of inertia about its mass center. You can call it I also. Usually you see I, so that is J. So we refer to J. Okay. So it's a general description of the problem. Now we are really going to make it very, very simple. So now what we have learned that, okay, I have a rigid body. It's a planar rigid body. And what I am going to study? I am going to study simple spring mass systems. Therefore, what we will do, we will simply try to draw the free body diagram of that system and we will put the inertia forces into the free body and simply take the static equilibrium. Okay, so that will go very, very fast and we can finish this session also as early as we can. Okay. Now let us assume that we have a mass and we have also spring attached to that mass, and this mass is on a frictionless surface, smooth frictionless surface. And what we are essentially doing is that we are giving it a small oscillation. So let's say if I apply a force PT, we can either talk about a forced vibration or we can either talk about a free vibration, both ways. Let's say what I have displaced is here forced vibration. So I give it a PT. Now question is, as per the Newton's second law, how do I write the Newton's second law? P minus kx equals to mass times acceleration. So P minus kx is the resultant force along x direction, and that must be equals to mass times acceleration. So body is actually accelerating along the same direction. But if I want to go to the D'Alembert's principle, then a priori, I will just say that there is a inertia force. And that inertia force is simply going to be mx double dot, where x is the displacement, and we put this double dot, you know, in order to reduce the time of writing, it's a notation. So d2x over dt2, that's my acceleration. So now I can write the D'Alembert principle that sum of force along x equals to 0. So ultimately what we see in this way is of the same form as that of the Newton's second law. So both is going to give me the same expression, but I am simply exercising this problem in two different ways.
But that force is a function of time, sir. Force are acting
on force is a function of time. In this case, everything is a function of time. My displacement, force, velocity, acceleration, everything is a function of time because I am talking about a dynamic problem. What advantage D'Alembert principle will give me, and we will immediately figure out, because we are talking about a planar motion, okay? Especially when we want to use the Newton's second law, we always resolve the moment about the mass center, right? And then we say that resultant moment equals to I times alpha, that is mass moment of inertia multiplied by angular acceleration. But in D'Alembert's principle, if we adopt, we will see that we don't have to do this thing at all. We can, in fact, take the moment about any point in the body. And we can say that, again, sum of moment about any point equals to 0. So that creates the, you know, basis of D'Alembert principle, and it simplifies our life. Okay? So let us go step by step. So now we have talked about a spring mass system, you know, where the gravity is not going to play an important role because in the motion was horizontal, so gravity was perpendicular to the reaction, and the acceleration was in the horizontal direction. Now if I really hang this system now, so what happens? First thing that we have to really understand that due to the gravity effect, I am going to have a spring force. So first I have to study the problem in terms of static equilibrium. So where is my equilibrium configuration? Okay? So once I do that, I can clearly see that spring force is going to be equals to k times delta st. Now delta st is the static displacement of the mass. Right? That is equals to mg. So that's my static equation. What I have done, I have simply, you know, calculated what is the equilibrium configuration of that mass. Next, what I am going to do, I am simply going to now pull this from the static equilibrium configuration, let's say by an amount xm. So xm is the magnitude of the displacement that I am giving, right? And also I give, let's say, velocity v0 and then release the system. Okay, so I just pull, give it a velocity also, and release the system. So it is basically going to now oscillate about the static equilibrium configuration. Okay, so now I am studying the problem from the static equilibrium configuration. Now what happens in this case? We can clearly see, if I look at the now motion of the body, let's say I consider the motion of the body at a distance x, from the static equilibrium configuration, so I can clearly draw a free body diagram. What is my free body diagram? Remember, now the spring force, that is equals to k del multiplied by the total displacement. Total displacement is delta st plus x. I also have the weight, that is the gravity mg, and mass times acceleration. Now remember, this one is only here I am concerned about the displacement x, because delta st is not a function of time. Okay? So mass times acceleration, that is my inertia force that I put in the body in an opposite direction. Now I take again equilibrium of that. So I say sum of force along x equals to 0. Ultimately what I get is this equation right here. Remember, I have already said that k delta st equals to mg, right? Therefore, mg and k delta st, they cancels each other. So I am going to get mx double dot plus kx equals to 0. So for this problem, if I measure the vibration from the static equilibrium configuration, that means I am assuming body is oscillating from the static equilibrium configuration, gravity does not influence the result. Gravity does not come into play at all. So there is no g in the equation of motion, okay? So I will now rewrite the equation of motion, that x double dot plus k over mx equals to 0, and I will just define a parameter which is omega n square. Now we call it natural circular frequency of vibration. Now why it is called, I will come next, but ultimately remember omega n square equals to k over m, then I can simply solve this differential equation. The general solution will be what is shown there, c1 sine omega n t plus c2 cosine omega n t, right? Okay, So now on this, what I am going to apply, I am going to apply my initial conditions, right? But because my initial condition was that at time t equals to 0, x equals to xm, right? And velocity was equals to v naught. Okay, so x dot was equals to v naught at t equals to t0. Okay, so once I do that, then we can actually put the initial condition and I can solve the problem based on the initial displacement, okay, and initial velocity. So x0 and v0. There was a misprint here. So this should be c1, okay, because at t equals to 0, and this should be x0, by the way. Okay, so there is a small misprint there. Now, how do I, when I plot this, so I'm simply going to plot it. So therefore, I can look at its motion. So this is the displacement versus time here. Now remember, what is happening in this case? How do I actually tell, describe this motion, why that's angular, you know, circular natural frequency is coming into play? So think about this, that at a given time t, my solution is x. That means the displacement of the spring is actually OP, right? So what is happening? The motion along the x-axis of the spring is governed by a particle that is actually moving in a circumference of a circle. Okay? So in other words, any position of this spring can be defined as if a particle is moving along this circle. And we can clearly see that this is my maximum amplitude that is possible. So for completing one cycle, going from here to here and then coming back, that's my spring motion, right? The particle will actually complete 2 pi rotation, okay? So it will actually, revolution will be just one circle, okay? So it will complete one circle. Therefore, what we can say now from the time period of vibration, T, right, that is completing one cycle going from, you know, some, let's say, positive to again coming back to a positive displacement, that will be defined by 2 pi by omega n. So now that is properly connected, time period of vibration is properly connected with the natural circular frequency of the motion. Okay, so that's the interpretation of why this natural circular frequency is coming into play. Remember, there are other quantities. This is my maximum amplitude, so which is xm, and there is a phase lag. Now, what is the phase lag? Which part of it? Anyone? Which distance is phase lag? How do I decide this phase lag, this phi? Yes, so you can clearly see that curve starts from right here, so there is indeed a phase lag that is in time, right? Which is defined by this much of time, okay? And a complete cycle is really from here to here. One peak to the other peak, one positive to the other positive. Now in a similar way, therefore I know that the solution is really x equals to xm sine omega nt plus phi, that is the displacement of the spring. What is the velocity? Velocity will be therefore equals to x dot, that is dx over dt, and therefore my maximum amplitude of the velocity will be xm omega n, right? And the maximum acceleration is going to be xm omega n square. So all I have to remember are these three parameters. So remember that xm is equals to square root of v0 by omega square plus x0 square. Okay, now why did that come into picture? Because I had also given it a initial velocity. So if I make it 0, right, if let's say I just take the spring here and release it, then my V0 is equals to 0 at a time t equals to 0, right? So therefore, V0 will go away from the solution. So we can actually say xm equals to x0. In fact, you can clearly see that in that situation, that phi will also go away. That means actually your motion will start from here and going like this, right? So phase lag will disappear from the system. So it will start from x0, right, at t equals to 0, and it will follow that motion. Now we are going to go through simple problems. So let us assume that we have two types of, you know, spring mass systems I am using. One is connected in parallel, one is connected in series. Okay, and we want to really study that if I really pull this by 40 millimeter down, okay, and release the system, then what is the time period of vibration, what is the maximum velocity, and what is the maximum acceleration. Okay. Now, before I go to even solving this problem, I have to set up the equations of motion, right? So first take one problem at a time. So let us take this problem first. What I have, assume, I have already said that if I solve the problem from the static equilibrium configuration for this type of problem, right, then gravity will not enter into the equations of motion, right? So I will assume, let us assume that oscillation starts from static equilibrium configuration. So I am solving the problem from the static equilibrium configuration as reference, okay? So how do I draw the free body diagram immediately? Let's say I displace the system by this way. So this is my x in this case. However, you can change the direction. Just be careful with the directions of the forces and the inertia. So I have taken it up. And if I take it up, then what happens? These springs are going to be compression. And we know if the displacement is x, therefore we have k1x and k2x, right? And since the body is moving upwards, so inertia force will be downward. So equation of motion in turn becomes very simple. Mx double dot plus k1x plus k2x equals to 0. That's my vertical equilibrium. Okay. So now you can see that k1 and k2 can be combined to make an equivalent system. So that will be k1 plus k2. That means I can simply forget about these two springs and I can just say k equivalent time x. That is my spring force. Okay, so once I do this, all I had to get this k equivalent, then I can definitely get the natural frequency of circular natural frequency of vibration, k equivalent divided by m. So that is coming out to be this. Then we can get the time period 2 pi by omega. We can get the maximum velocity. That velocity is simply the displacement that was given. Remember, displacement given was 40 mm. Okay, that is to, you know, maximum displacement can be simply found by xm multiplied by omega n, and acceleration will be simply xm omega n square. Any question on this? Clear? So let's move on to the next one. How about this? First of all, understand one thing. Is it a 2 degree of freedom system or 1 degree of freedom system? It is only a 1 degree of freedom system. Why? Because there is no mass attached here. Okay, and what we can show, therefore, that let us say that this is being, you know, displaced by x1, this is being displaced by x. So ultimately, what we have to come to, we have to find k equivalent time x for the system as that of before. So ultimately, remember, in this problem, what remains constant? The force in the spring right, that should be same. Okay, so force is not changing. If you do the simple equilibrium, right, the transmitted force remains same in both the spring, and that's the key. That's the key to solve this problem. Okay, and what I have said here, therefore, just look here carefully, that I am really taking here that what is the P, that P is equals to, for the spring 2, that means this one, the K2X minus X1, that's the net compression, X minus X1, right? That must be equals to the force in the spring 1, that is K1 multiplied by X1. Okay, and you can clearly see now X2, X and X1 are now properly connected, so we get to this. So X1 is solved. Once X1 is solved, you again substitute it back here, right? So once we substitute it back here, we get K1, K2, K1 plus K2 multiplied by X. So I ultimately got my K equivalent for the system. So I can now replace these two spring by a one spring whose equivalent stiffness is given by K1, K2 divided by K1 plus K2. And the procedure will remain same. So rest will just follow how to get the maximum velocity and the maximum acceleration. Okay? So now we have discussed this. Now we are trying to come to really rigid body because we are going to, you know, study the motion of a rigid body, planar motion of a rigid body. Therefore, what I have here, I have just explained here in a different manner. First of all, let us assume that this bar, here it is being rotated about this pin. So what is the mass moment of inertia about the CG? We can simply calculate it based on the definition of mass moment of inertia, that is integral r squared dm, okay? And that we can say that if it has a distributed mass, that distributed mass is m bar. So this is mass per unit length, okay? So m bar is the mass per unit length, okay? So when I do the r squared dm, so what is my dm? Dm is simply m bar multiplied by dx. And then I basically integrate it from negative L over 2 to positive L over 2. So I get the j. So j should be given by capital M L square over 2L. What is the capital M? That's the total mass. Okay? So therefore, what I can immediately write that now when I am going to apply the D'Alembert's principle, how I am going to show this inertia force, right? So now I have shown the inertia force. So what is my JCG about the center of gravity? The inertia, rotational inertia should be shown like this because it is trying to oppose the motion of the body. So ultimately, we have to remember this, that mass moment of inertia, that is the rotational inertia of the body about its own centroid, is equals to m L square over 2L for a bar of length L with a total mass m. Now, let us say what happens if I really move this one to here. That means now I would assume instead of rotating about its own CG, it is actually rotating about some point, let's say at left. Anyone has the answer? M L square over 3 will be answer. You can again follow the exact same, you know, definition here. So only thing what you are doing is changing the integration limit from 0 to L and look at the solution. Because now your rotation point is actually at the extreme end, right? So I have to now change the integration limit from 0 to L, not from negative L over 2 to L over 2. See, that's how we get the answer. The answer ultimately should be equals to about a m L square over 3. Now, when I show it in terms of D'Alembert principle, remember, I have already stated that the translatory inertia force should be concentrated at the CG. its own CG, okay? And there also is going to be rotational inertia that we can put anywhere, no issue. But ultimately now, to study this problem in terms of D'Alembert principle, we will resort to this. What we are going to say, this body is now trying to rotate about this point A. Now that motion will be decomposed into two parts, as if the body is being purely translated, and then it is rotated about its own CG. So think of now, we replace the entire body by just a lumped mass here, and that lumped mass is equals to m bar L equals to m, and that m, what is happening to that? This is actually undergoing a pure translation, as well as that lumped mass is being rotated about its own CG. That means there are two inertia forces coming into play when I want to define the free body diagram of this particular system. So what I have done here, I have shown the free body diagram where this is my translator inertia force, right? And look at why it is like that, because the displacement right here is equals to, if the rotation is theta, then the displacement L by 2 multiplied by theta, right? Okay, so velocity will be L by 2 theta dot, and the acceleration will be L by 2 theta double dot. That's my translational acceleration. Okay, L by 2 theta double dot. So we multiply that by m, so I get the translational inertia force. Plus, it is also rotating about its own CG, and that we already know the solution. That we have already shown that it is going to be always m L squared by 2L multiplied by theta double dot. Now look at how easy it is. What I really want to do, I want to now going back to very first class, that is my equivalent force couple system. Yes. No, this one?
Yeah.
This one is for the total body. This is rotating about its own CG.
No, sir. Earlier we took the total length as L, and that theta dot worked out to be L squared by 12 into J theta.
That is M L squared by 12 theta double dot if the total body's length L.
L. Now yeah. L by 2 only it is.
No, it is still L. Look at this thing I have written here. So what the body is doing, you see the body that it is actually purely translation.
I got.
Plus it is rotating. Remember, you have to be consistent with the constraint at the left end. Body can't be detached from the constraint at the left end. Okay? So it is actually rotating about that point right here. We are simply decomposing. So I take the bar up, then again I rotate it and put it back. That's all. Very simple. So as if now I said, okay, it has a pure translation, which is simply, you know, what is the translation amount of the center, that is L by 2 times theta, that's the translation. And then it is actually rotating about its own mass center, so that is M L squared 12 theta double dot. Now what is the definition of equivalent system? Now I want to transfer, so now this system right here and that system, they are going to be equal, so equivalent. So that means what I'll do, I want to find out what is my rotational inertia about this A, right? So I simply can say that I take the moment of this about A, right? That will give me the equivalent moment, right? So that equivalent moment is what I am looking at. So what is my equivalent moment? It is written here. This is actually a couple moment, so that can be transferred anywhere in the body, and this one will go with a multiplied by L over 2. Is that clear? So I ultimately get the same answer as I do using the formula. In fact, I am here even not talking about parallel axis theorem. All I said that I want to create an equivalent system and I can transfer the equivalent moment to at some point A about which the body is rotating. So I don't have to even explain what is my parallel axis theorem. You can do that also using parallel axis theorem. Okay. Is that clear? Because that is the basis of whatever we are going to discuss from now. So let us look at this problem. Again, I have a spring mass system, but look at the arrangement. One spring is upward, another spring is downward. And what I want to first make sure that the bar, let's say assume that there is a mass here. Let's try to assume this bar is massless to begin with. Okay. So first we assume that there is no mass attached to this bar, but there is a lumped mass at the right of this bar, which is massless. Okay. So in other words, the mass of this lumped mass is larger compared to the mass of the bar. Okay. So how do I develop the, let's say, equation of motion first of all, and then I can definitely find the natural frequency of vibration and also the time period of vibration. So again, can we think of like this way? Once I give you this problem, first of all, what is going to happen? It is going to be under, let's say, gravity, right? And it is going to actually get a static equilibrium configuration, right? So let us say, what is my static equilibrium configuration? So first problem is simply a static problem. So what happens? Due to the gravity, it is going to come down. Let's say it came down by delta ST, okay? And remember, so this is my displacement diagram. So what is the force diagram? Force diagram will be simply this spring is going to be under tension, and this spring is going to be under compression. Now look at the direction of forces. If it is under tension, then it will be upward, right? And if it is under compression, it is also going to be upward. Because in both cases, one is creating the pull on the body, and another one is the push in the body. So in the free body diagram, they are actually going to be in the same direction. Okay. Now you have the gravity. So this is mg. So once I do the moment about point A, I get this equation. So that is my static equation. And we can get, you know, basically the static displacement here. Now what I said, that I am always going to do, you know, release that. Now I am going to oscillate that system from the static equilibrium configuration. So if I do that, what happens? So that's my static equilibrium configuration. And now I am saying that, okay, the motion is now being measured from the static equilibrium configuration. So it is basically going to oscillate like this about its equilibrium configuration. What I want to really prove in this problem is that if the body oscillates about static equilibrium configuration in this case, again, the gravity will not enter into the equation of motion. Can we show that? Okay. So now take a look at the, you know, this is my displacement now. Now from the displacement, I could again get the forces, right? And I can create this force diagram. So what is my force diagram? Look at the net displacement of the spring, right? So it has came down, and then I have taken it up. Therefore, the spring, top spring, is under compression, right? Okay. So now top spring under compression, so I have put the sign downward. In this case, similarly, this one will be, however, in tension, right? So in this case also it will be downward on the body, right? So it is creating the same effect as before. So ultimately I have two downward forces coming from the spring force, and then I have mg, and then I have the inertia force which is being acted downward. That's how I draw the free body diagram. Okay. Again, take the moment about A equals to 0. What is my final outcome? Final outcome will be equals to this. Yes.
Sir, in this second FBD, it is written over there or on the upper side, it is 1 by 3 of XT.
Yes.
So XT
is measured from the static equilibrium configuration to upward.
Okay, it is the that particular distance maybe, and 1 by 3 because you are taking movement about some point.
Means, no, 1 over 3 is the, if you look at the span, all are L.
Yeah,
okay, that is so that was assumed. So ultimately, you have 3L as a span, okay. Right? Okay, so therefore, it is at the 1/3 distance from the, okay. So that distance is L over 3. Similarly, for the second spring, it is at 2L over 3.
It means that for the lower ground, we are shown that it is delta ST. But for the upper side, it is a function of X in terms of T.
X in terms of T, exactly. Okay. Because I am right. Now, so first is the delta ST is my static displacement. Now the system is oscillating from the static displacement.
Because distances are same, that is why it is a 1 by 3, 2 by 3 and X.
Exactly.
Right.
Okay. Is that clear? I mean, this is what you even do in case of virtual work. You know, yesterday we talked about it, okay, because these are all small oscillations, so we can do that way. Okay. So now if I do moment about A, then I am going to get this equation. Remember, this is already a static equation. That is what I have derived in the previous slide, that what is my static is this, right? So therefore, again, this is going to go away. So ultimately, I get this equation, which does not have any gravity effect. Now in this problem, why there is no gravity effect actually entering? Because remember, the action of the gravity is always the springs. But if you think of an inverted pendulum or a pendulum, you have always seen that gravity is going to act. Gravity will enter into the equation of motion. Why? Because gravity will produce the disturbing torque, and spring will always produce. In this case, what is that is balanced. The disturbing torque is balanced by the spring. But in case of a pendulum, even if I attach the spring, what happens? As soon as I oscillate the system, there is simply going to be an angular momentum that is created by the gravity, which is not going to be balanced by the spring. So there will be always a disturbing torque that will try to, you know, rotate that system, trying to make it unstable. Okay, so any problem that concerns with an inverted pendulum or a pendulum, you will always see that gravity will enter into the equation of motion. You won't be able to, you know, nullify it. There is no way. Okay, so we'll just go to that problem later on. Now, what is shown here is that if I just assume that if I ignore the gravity effect, let's say, if I don't take the gravity effect from the very beginning, all right, so I am going to get the same equation as before. So I need not to complex my life. What I'm trying to say, I need not to, you know, kind of worry about where is the static equilibrium configuration for this type of problems. So I can simply assume, okay, I do have a static equilibrium configuration. In fact, I can assume that static equilibrium configuration is my original configuration, and I can simply try to calculate the oscillation from that static equilibrium. And my answer will not change. Okay? So you can clearly see what is happening in this case. I have precisely dropped the mg effect. That is not there. Okay? So mg effect is dropped, and I am going to again solve this problem, and I get the same equation. Okay? So now let's move on to the next one. So far we have assumed that there is no distributed mass here. Yes.
Approach, like we can write the energy for the springs and differentiate it, this will give the force,
well, there is
that
also,
will be equal to
that is also dot. Approach, in fact, what I will come easier. To that, just wait, I will come to that. In fact, why I am taking moment here, we have already studied virtual work, right? We have already studied virtual work, right? Do I have to really take moment? I can simply say the virtual work done by these forces equals to zero. And I will get the same equation back. The reason being, these are actually my active force system. What are my active forces here? Spring forces, inertia forces, right? So if I, now I am already said that this is my equilibrium configuration. Now what virtual work principle states? That if I give it an infinitesimally small displacement, which is consistent with the constraints, then the virtual work done by the active forces undergoing the virtual displacement will be equals to zero, right? That means the work done by the active forces should be equals to zero. And that is what, you know, you spent the whole morning yesterday. We can simply derive this equation of motion based on that. What I will do, I don't take the moment, I will simply distort this system by a small amount, let's say delta, theta or something, and I can simply calculate what is the work done of all the forces acting, and I will set that equals to zero, I will definitely get this equation back. Okay? Yes?
Sir, can't we use the D'Alembert principle straight away for this problem?
What?
D'Alembert principle.
For what?
For this, for solving the solution straight away by taking that angular deflection.
No, that has been used. This is what D'Alembert principle we are doing. Because we are using the inertia force which is opposing the motion.
How do you use that angular? Because there is angular displacement. Can't you take I alpha?
I alpha is already there. In this case, why I alpha is not coming into play? See, remember, I have not taken the mass here, right? This bar is massless. Now look at the next problem, therefore, that will actually remove your worry. So let us assume now this bar has a distributed mass. So if that is so, then what D'Alembert principle states? Okay, first I put the translational inertia force that is at its mass center. So what is the mass center for that bar? It is exactly at the middle. So that is 3L over 2, right? Okay. So remember, therefore, what is being put here? You can see clearly that total length is 3L, right? So if you do that way, so what is the displacement of this point? L over 2 multiplied by theta, capital L over 2 multiplied by theta. Therefore, what is the acceleration? L over 2 theta double dot. So that will create the translational inertia force. And then I have the rotational inertia about its own mass center. So that rotational inertia force is m L square over 12. That is already proven. So ultimately, whenever I see a system like this, and it is actually disturbed at any point except for his mass center, that means I am really talking about rotation about any other point than mass center, then what we can do, we can simply have the lumped mass at the mass center, and that lumped mass will undergo both translational motion as well as rotational motion. And that will give me translational force as well as rotational inertia force. Okay? So that's how I draw the free body diagram. Now, if you do that straightforward exercise.
Sir, one small doubt.
Yes.
Why do we use the symbol tau in place of t for time?
What is tau?
Time period.
No. This is what is happening. I am assuming this.
No, not here. In general.
Time period is tau.
So far, you have used the symbol for time as a tau, small.
That is for time period of vibration, that is 2 pi by omega n.
Asking why, is there any specific reason?
There is no specific reason. You can also use capital T. Okay, so capital T is also normally used, but that is just a notation here. But this problem that we are discussing now is really I am creating the static equilibrium at an instant of time T. Okay, and there, that is why I am saying that at an instant of time T, what is the displacement? That is xt, x as a function of t. This is x as a function of t, okay? Oh, I think that is the confusion produced. Why did I put this bracket? Was that the question? Okay. No, that is okay. So let's, you can keep it capital T, okay?
Yes, thank you.
So now in this case, we get this equation. What I want to show you quickly, suppose I do the virtual work. Can we do the virtual work and show, you know, get the same answer? How do I do it? So, okay, so what we have done basically, now this is my equilibrium configuration, right? And what we have done, we have given it a virtual displacement delta theta. Now remember that delta theta is artificial in nature and has no relationship with the real displacement or real theta that is taking place. So we can clearly show that we can calculate the virtual displacement at the concerned location where the forces are acting, right? And we can get the work done, you know, for each and every forces. So we can clearly see how much work is done by this force, let's say. The work done is equals to K1 1/3 x L delta theta, okay? Similarly, we can, you know, look at the other spring force right here, so that is done. So likewise, we can get the, you know, for the inertia forces, what are the virtual work done. And you can carry out this straightforward procedure, answer will be same. But remember one point, virtual work does not give any advantage if we are just considering a single rigid body. Because you have seen that virtual work is mostly used for interconnected bodies, and you can calculate certain forces very easily using the virtual work. So it does not provide any advantage whatsoever in case of a single rigid body. Okay. So I just wanted to show that that is also approach. In fact, D'Alembert principle was, you know, kind of takes into this virtual work into account. Okay, now. So in this problem, we have a rectangular block resting on a frictionless surface, and we want to derive the equation of motion for small oscillation in its own horizontal plane. So remember, the problem is like this. So the reason I have taken like this is because we want to eliminate the gravity effect, okay? So let's not think about the gravity effect. So it is actually in motion in a horizontal plane. Can we solve the equation of motion for small oscillations? Problem is clear? So again, this end is pin and we have a spring there. So see, we can very quickly draw the, you know, free body diagram for this system. So let us say, how do I go about it? First, I get the displacement diagram. Okay, so displacement diagram will look like this. There is again a misprint. There is no static equilibrium again. So just remove this one and just think of it that it is rotating about its own horizontal axis. Okay, and therefore, what we have, if we calculate the displacement diagram, what happens to the mass center? The mass center will now undergo horizontal translation as well as vertical translation, right? Okay, so that means what are the inertia force coming into play? What are the inertia forces coming into play? Remember, the displacement here is b by 2 times theta, and displacement here is equals to A over 2 multiplied by theta. Therefore, the translator inertia force, if we look at it, So I am going to get a translational inertia force upward here, translational inertia force leftward, and as well as it is rotating about its own mass center. So there are three inertia forces that is coming into play if I assume that body is lumped at its mass center. Okay. So with that, then what we can do, remember I have used this gamma. So gamma is the actually mass per unit area I have assumed. So let us think of a uniform thickness. Okay, otherwise what will happen if I say gamma equals to specific weight, that thickness is coming into play. So it will be, you know, A, B, T will come everywhere. So T will come everywhere in your equation if I just use gamma as specific weight. So what I have done here, gamma is being taken as mass per unit area. Okay. So just look at this free body diagram and see how easy it is now for us to solve this problem. All I have to do is take the moment about O equal, yes, you know, zero. Sir. Yes.
Sir, in the first FPD, will there be the opposite A by 2 and B by 2 theta?
Opposite means?
Means for vertical displacement.
Vertical displacement is given by, this is virtual, again, go back to virtual logal, small displacement. So therefore, what is happening, if you keep looking from this, so B over 2 theta will push that mass center here, right? Plus it is going to come down by A over 2 theta, right? So there are two displacement taking place. One is horizontal, one is vertical. And therefore, I have inertia force on both ways. Translational inertia force is coming both ways. And then I just add the rotational inertia force of the mass center, which is equals to capital M A square plus B square by 12. That's my inertia force about the mass center. Okay. So we solve this problem again. So it is actually going to be equals to, you see clearly that capital M A square plus B square over 3, that is what we are going to get if we really transfer all these three forces right here. So what is my mass moment of inertia, let's say about point O? See, for a bar, for a straight bar, it was M L square over 3, right? So for this plate, it has two dimensions, A and B. So it is basically M A square by 3 plus M B square over 3. That should be the answer if I'm talking about the inertia force, mass moment of inertia about O. Okay. So we can verify that by logic also. But what is most easy here is that we can quickly create this free body diagram and try to show all the effect of inertia forces on that body. So final answer will be, this is your natural circular frequency and this is time period of vibration. Okay. Now this is again a very nice problem here. Now we are going to think about a horizontal bar, let's say, and we have also a mass on the top. Now remember, in this case, what is again assumed that BC is massless. That is the whole idea here. So assume BC is massless, okay? And if BC does not have mass, then how do I get the equation of motion for this problem? So it is very similar to the one that, spring system that we have studied. Okay, we have spring system in series where there was no lumped mass at the middle of two. So in this case, you remember we are able to convert that problem a single degree of freedom this system. So we have started with a 2 degree of freedom system, but we are able to show that 1 degree of freedom is related to the other degree of freedom statically. Okay, just because there was no mass in one of those spring, attached to that spring. So in this case, it's a similar problem. So how do I start it? So let us assume I have a xA is the displacement here and xD is the displacement here. Okay, so these are my 2 degrees of freedom. Okay, so if I do that, then what is going to happen? Now let's look at the force diagram, so free body diagram of both. So ultimately this spring is being, so this is the net effect, so K2 XA minus XD, right? And then we have here, from here we have K1 XA, right, on this body. And here we have K3 XD. Okay, so now if you look at the equilibrium of this body, then we can clearly say that what will happen is that this will be statically linked. Okay, so I'll get a solution between XA and XD. So what is being done? First, I take the equation of motion of this. So equation of motion of this is given by here. Then in the next slide, I take a moment about C. So moment about C, when it is taken, then I can see that XD is related to XA. Okay? And once I do that, therefore it is converted to a single degree of freedom system. So whole purpose of doing this problem is to show that there are certain problems where we can convert it to a single degree of freedom system. We start with a 2 degree of freedom system because just that we don't have a mass in one of the systems, therefore it is statically correlated. Okay? So we get the equation of motion, and remember this will be my equivalent stiffness as such for this particular body, and therefore we have the natural frequency of vibration. Okay. So we are just going through series of problem. What? Yes.
Sir, in most of the cases we are not taking the mass of the spring. My point is the spring is taking the all the restoring forces. So yes. Why aren't we taking the mass of the spring?
Because that is usual assumptions we make, because its stiffness is very high compared to the gravity effect that you can actually take into account. So we assume that spring constant is relatively higher. So that K times U, right, that will actually cancel, or that is actually very large compared to if you just consider the mass of the spring. And that is always engineering practice.
Okay. Sir, last problem.
Yes. This problem? Previous one, yeah.
Here the direction of force at D should be double direction.
XA is taken up, right? So your XA minus XD. So that will be net tensile. That is a net tension going in, right? So XA minus XD. So if you think that way, that means that spring is stretched. Okay? Right? So that is given as a upward. Whereas in this case, this is also spring is stretched. See, like this is also stretched, but it will come down on the free body, right? Okay? Clear? Okay, now this rod AB is attached to a hinge A, and we have two springs connected. So what we want to do now, this is a very interesting problem. Determine the value of K for which the period of small oscillation is 1 second and infinite. So there are two questions asked. What would be the value of the K such that time period of oscillation is either 1 second in the first case, and in the other case it is going to infinite? This is a very, very good problem to look at, and we'll explain why. See, first of all, let us just try to get the equation of motion. So again, it will be very straightforward. So let's say I give it a small oscillation theta. So if I give it a theta, let's say, then what is my forces coming into play? So remember, there are two springs attached here. This spring is going to be stretched, so tensile force, so that will act outward from the body, and this spring is going to be compressed, right? That is again going to act towards the body, but net effect is always going to be leftward, okay? Right? So we have that here. Now we have K d theta, K d theta, and if we look at the inertia force right here of this lumped mass that was a mass attached here, then we can clearly see the height was h. So displacement was h theta, Therefore, the translatory inertia force is mh theta double dot. Okay? And now you have mg also. Now there is a disturbing torque, which will never be balanced by the springs. So the static equilibrium configuration that we have in this case is indeed vertical itself. Okay? And once we distort that, then we are going to get a disturbing torque, which is going to come into play. So ultimately, you know, the answer would be easy. Now we just take the moment about A and we find the solution. Okay? Now what it said is that we have two questions now. One is the time period of vibration was 1 second, right? And another case, it was infinite. So what happens? If I say time period is 1 second, then I can just say t equals to 2 pi by omega n, and I get the value of k from this, right? K was unknown. K was unknown. What is the spring constant? In the second case, I get k value to be equals to this. So we can compare these two values. In one case, first case, stiffness is high, right? That means system is, how do I define the system? It's a rigid system, right? Okay. And it was a stable equilibrium. Now this problem you can actually solve through the potential energy approach. What happens, what does it mean by t equals to infinite? T infinite means it is oscillating very slowly coming back. Let's say. That means, in other words, it is not coming back. Actually, what happens once it is gone like this, it is just unstable. So that means what we can show, you can calculate backward. Let's say I assume k equals to this, and can I show using potential energy approach that the system is indeed unstable for k to be less than this. Is that clear? Okay, so we are going to solve that type of problem in the tutorial. So remember, omega n equals to 0 is a static condition, right? Okay, because time period of oscillation is very infinity. So we have actually trying to resemble the static condition here. So what we can show for this k value less than, you know, this, whenever we have this situation arises, therefore the system will be unstable. And you can do simply potential energy. Forget about dynamic. Potential energy approach, just proceed with that. K less than equals to this, your system has to be unstable for theta equals to 0 degree. That's the answer. Clear? Okay. Now, this will be the last problem to work on. A bit complex, but again, now remember this is kind of a frame system. So I have a frame system in hand. I have two bars attached to it. So this is welded right here. So we have basically, you know, that's a L-shaped bar. It is attached by a spring. I am also considering the distributed load everywhere. So we have a mass per unit length for these two bars, and I have a lumped mass at the end. Can I solve it? Equation of motion. Now we have to think of, you know, very systematically in this case, that how different masses are actually participating in the inertia forces. And that we can do simply by look at, if I give it a small rotation theta, as you have done also in case of virtual work, what are the different displacement that is being taken place, okay, at the concerned location? How system is displaced? And once we identify the displacements at each and every individual point of our concern, then we can basically put all the inertia forces correctly. So just look at it carefully. What happens to this mass, let's say this bar? So as per D'Alembert principle, I'm going to consider a lumped mass right here, right? At the center of it. So that lumped mass, how much it is translated? Translated by L by 2 multiplied by theta. That's the only translation in small displacement. Okay, therefore my inertia force is m multiplied by L by 2 theta double dot. That's my translator inertia force. Clear? I do have also rotational inertia force, that is my J about the CG, because it is actually rotating about this point right here, right? And therefore the lump mass will make its own rotation, right, about the center, okay? So I have J is equals to how much? J should be equals to M L square over 2L, okay, for a bar. Now when I go to this point right here, if I assume that I have a lumped mass right here, now what is happening in this case, this point is displaced both horizontally as well as vertically. So I have two displacements attached to that point, okay, right? Similarly, this mass will also have two displacements attached to it. If I just go by the small oscillation, small, you know, displacement, then I just make sure that I calculate all the displacements correctly. So therefore, the inertia forces, if I look at it, remember, this body is able to rotate about its mass center as well as it is actually making adjustments for the displacement that is being taken place. So therefore, in this mass, I am going to have three inertia forces. One is coming from the horizontal translation, another is from the vertical translation, the other one is about its own axis it is rotating. Is that clear? For this mass, however, I am going to have just a translatory inertia force, because this is kind of, you know, this is a lumped mass right here. So that is properly attached with this bar. So I have a horizontal translatory force and I have a vertical translatory force. So it's very easy. Practically, it's very easy. As long as we understand that small displacement and how each and every point, or rather the lumped masses, are being moved in a rigid body. So we get all the inertia forces and we take, either we do virtual work or we set sum of moment across to zero. Now remember, what I have not considered in this problem, I have assumed already that ignore the gravity effect. Do you think in this problem gravity will come into the equation of motion? It is actually an inverted pendulum problem. It is an inverted pendulum problem. Because that, what is happening once this mass is shifted, they are all going to create a disturbing torque about the pin. The gravity effect will create the disturbing torque about the pin. Therefore, what happens? The gravity actually comes into the equation of motion. But I have not considered in my solution. So that will be, you know, you can go back and kind of exercise this. That really, if I look at a static equilibrium configuration first, so take into account the gravity effect, then you displace the system from the static equilibrium configuration, then what is the equation of motion? It's going to change.
Sir, I have one suggestion regarding this kind of problem, sir.
Yes.
The approach that you have done is all right, no problem. But earlier slide, you have proved that the center of rotation, if you are considering individual bars, in that case, you have to considering both translation and rotation.
Yes.
In fact, this is making a bit difficult.
But, no, but that is the proper D'Alembert principle. See, we cannot move the eye. If you are doing this,
well,
let's say I calculate the mass center about this.
Yes, I am talking about A.
About
A, it is taking pure rotation.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Because A is the instantaneous center of rotation.
Yes.
So if you take moment of inertia and everything about that point, it will...
You can actually figure out the moment of inertia about that point will be equal to this.
Ultimately, exactly. So if we take the whole system about that point, moment of inertia, it will be
very
easy.
But see, this is less prone to actually...
From understanding point of view, that is okay. But for solving, that will be much more easier if you take about A.
If you want to go that way, I have no objection to that. But that is not a proper D'Alembert principle, just keep in mind.
But we can prove that it will be same
because
about that point.
What happened, D'Alembert said the individual masses needs to be lumped. So we are going to first consider where is the mass center? Where is the mass center of the individual system? And we are looking at the, you know, displacement of those centers, and we are simply taking the effect of the inertia forces onto that. But what you said, yes, we can solve the problem by, you know, solving the mass moment of inertia about that point itself.
Exactly.
But this is more visible, I would say you can get an immediate feedback that, okay, what is happening to the system.
But difficult to solve, considering both motion.
No, not at all. I don't buy that.
At the free end, where the mass is there, you have considered the two displacements, x and y.
Where?
At the free end, mass m. Displacement diagram.
Yes.
At the free end, you have considered the two displacements, x and y. At the corner, why there is only one displacement along the x only?
Where? No, no, look at carefully here.
Junction
see,
point.
See, this m, small m.
Go to the diagram. Displacement diagram.
Yeah, so what happens?
At the junction, when the bent is moving to the right.
That one, small m or which one you are saying?
Small
m.
Just see at the corner.
Yes.
Corner.
Yes.
When you are moving the body to the bent to the right.
Yes.
You have given the, yes, we have considered the x displacement.
We have x and y both.
No, y is not.
Look at this, no? Inertia forces.
At the corner I am talking about. Corner.
Here.
Corner. Junction point.
Junction?
Huh.
Why do I have to consider the junction?
In displacement diagram. In displacement diagram.
Yes. That is only L theta. That is small oscillation, right? We have done this even virtual work. These are all small oscillation. So you cannot get a vertical component. If I have a body like this and I rotate by theta, very small, then what is the displacement in first order? That is L theta horizontally only. There is no displacement in the first order vertically. Okay?
Okay.
Right? Okay.